escuchan? ¿Sí? Vale. Bueno, buenos días, bienvenidas, bienvenidos, bienvenides. Hoy empezamos el tercer día de Decidim Fest, con el foco además puesto en Decidim. Mi nombre es Pablo, soy de Aragón, investigador en la Fundación Wikimedia, y también miembro del equipo de Decidim, de la Asociación del Comité de Coordinación de las Iniciativas de Decidim y de la organización también de Decidim Fest. Y como comentaba, hoy es el tercer día y tras dos primeros días donde hemos ido revisando diferentes experiencias en torno al rol de la democracia, la tecnología, en la justicia global, hoy vamos a aterrizarlo más en todas las experiencias que se han ido desarrollando a lo largo de este año en torno a Decidim. Y cuando se preparó un poco la call de este año, se estuvo pensando, estuvo esperando que aparecerían diferentes instancias sobre diferentes geografías, diferentes latitudes. Instancias novedosas respecto al uso de nuevas tecnologías o el tipo de organizaciones que iban a hacer, que las iban a desplegar. Pero una cosa que nos sorprendió gratamente y que es lo que vamos a abordar en la sesión es que hubo tres propuestas que abordaban un tema común. Y además un tema común que no era un tema cualquiera, un tema que es especialmente simbólico en el caso de Decidim, como es la ciencia ciudadana. Y digo que es especialmente simbólico porque hace tres años, en los seminarios de investigación del lab de Meta Decidim, estuvimos discutiendo con diferentes personas de la comunidad de ciencia ciudadana de Barcelona y Cataluña sobre cómo poder aunar una visión participativa de la ciencia como la ciencia ciudadana y también la visión participativa de la democracia que impulsaba Decidim para impulsar un paradigma de toma de decisiones y formulación de políticas públicas basadas en evidencia científica, pero participada a lo largo de todo el proceso. Por eso me hace especial ilusión poder estar hoy en esta sesión sobre ciencia ciudadana participativa y además haciendo hincapié en este énfasis, aunque parezca redundante, en ciencia ciudadana bien entendida a través de la participación. Y para esto, para no gastar más tiempo, hoy tenemos nuestra primera ponente, que es Franziska Peter, de López Sisters, de la Universidad de Barcelona, donde nos presentará el trabajo que han estado realizando con el CoActuem que están realizando en este momento con el proyecto europeo CoActuem. Adelante.
Muy buenos días a todos y a todas. De parte de Open Systems, os queremos presentar hoy nuestro proyecto más importante de momento. Y a ver si mis transparencias ya llegarán. Vale. Y os queremos presentar nuestro proyecto más importante de momento, que se llama CoActuem por la salud mental. Y es un proyecto europeo de Horizon 2020 que trabaja sobre ciencias modernas, como va a decir Pablo ahora. CoActuem por la salud mental, especialmente queremos tratamos de entender mejor las redes de soporte o de apoyo de salud mental. Y lo queremos entender mejor por un chatbot que estamos programando especialmente para esta ciencia. Bueno, esta ciencia que hacemos dentro del proyecto promotor que se llama CoAct, hacemos ciencia ciudadana social y entonces nos interesamos especialmente por las preocupaciones sociales. Y aquí trabajamos con diferentes grupos, por un lado los profesionales de la área en que trabajamos y por segundo lo que llamamos los expertos y que luego son nuestros co-investigadores, que son las personas que tienen esta preocupación social y entonces son los que más que nadie tienen también una experiencia y por eso son expertos en su campo. Vale. Los profesionales en el proyecto de CoActuem por la salud mental claramente son los profesionales de salud mental y nuestros co-investigadores en el proyecto son personas, primeras personas con problemas de salud mental o familiares de estas personas. Y los co-investigadores realmente son las protagonistas en el proyecto y hacen un parte muy activo de todas las etapas de la ciencia, empezando con la creación de la herramienta de medición, que en nuestro caso es un chatbot, luego interpretación de datos y al final también pasar a la acción, que claro, es una ilusión muy grande para los co-investigadores. En la etapa actual en que estamos, el codiseño del chatbot, las cosas que han hecho los co-investigadores son que han llenado el chatbot con lo que ahora son los contenidos, han también participado mucho en el diseño del chatbot con sus críticas y ideas, y ahora también están promoviendo la difusión y planeando la difusión con nosotros. Así que realmente, como en todas las etapas, son muy presentes. Por redes de apoyo en salud mental, entendemos el entorno de cada persona, el entorno emocional y social de cada persona. Entonces, todos nosotros y todos vosotros hacéis parte de estas redes. Y en el chatbot queremos medir estas redes preguntando tres preguntas principales al lado de microvivencias que presentan los conversadores. Y veis un ejemplo aquí al lado, que tenemos un pequeño dibujo y una vivencia escrita, y luego preguntamos tres tipos de preguntas. El participante en el chatbot ha vivido una experiencia parecida. ¿Conoce a alguien que haya vivido una experiencia parecida, o cómo actuaría en la situación presentada? Y con esto queremos medir los vínculos entre las personas con la salud mental. Quiero aclarar que, como en el chatbot, hay dos grupos mayores. Uno son los co-investigadores, y han llenado el chatbot con vida y son los más interesados en los datos que creamos. Y los otros son los participantes, y esperamos que sean unos 5.000 personas en el chatbot. Y ellos interactúan con el chatbot a través de botones y dan sus respuestas. Y entonces nos dan los datos, digamos. Vale, el chatbot será en cuatro idiomas: en catalán, en castellano, en alemán y en inglés. El chatbot es un programa en Python, trabaja sobre un database de MongoDB, y el código está presentado en GitHub. Así que si os interesa, podéis entrar. En Decidim encontramos un partner muy perfecto para nuestro proyecto, porque a un lado podemos presentar nuestros fases de receta perfectamente con lo que son los pasos de data en Decidim, y también podemos dar los permisos a los diferentes grupos que nosotros tenemos, como los co-investigadores, tenemos los profesionales de salud mental, y está perfectamente presentado en CoActuem.org, que es una página web de Decidim. Y muchas gracias a Decidim por lograr este punto con nosotros. Y al fin quiero decir que agradecemos muchas preguntas, porque en 7 minutos no podemos dar mucha información. Y si os interesa, podéis entrar a la web. Me quedaré un rato aquí, y también mi colega Isabel está aquí por responder cualquier pregunta sobre la página web. Y si queréis entrar al chatbot, aquí está escrito cómo funciona. Entonces, muchas gracias.
No lo comentaba al principio de la sesión, como no cabemos todas en el escenario, vamos a ir saltando de ponente en ponente, y vamos a tomar la ronda de preguntas al final, un poco también para intentar impulsar preguntas que sean más transversales en torno a Catalan y presentar este proyecto, y así poder generar un debate más holístico. Entonces, nuestros siguientes ponentes tenemos a Maite López, de la Universidad de Barcelona, y a Jesús, Cerquides, del Instituto de Inteligencia Artificial, del Decidim, y nos hablarán de su propuesta de Decidim for Cities and Sites. Adelante.
So, thank you, Pablo. So what I'm going to talk today is this platform called Decidim for Cities and Sites, and the idea is it's developed Crowd for SDG project. It's a European project which has two objectives mainly: to help young people bring forward citizen science projects, of these projects, analyze whether these projects are able to track the progress towards obtaining the sustainable development goals. And this is done with a set of partners, which are down below. I'm not going to get into the details, but I'm going to signal out that the United Nations is one of the partners, and this is helping us a lot in understanding what the SDGs are. Okay, so let's start discussing a little bit what is citizen science. Citizen science is basically science which is done with the help of citizens in different ways. And there are many ways in which you can incorporate citizens, and this has been already investigated from the research point of view, and we can start at the lowest level. We just ask citizens to provide us images or data. At the second level, called distributed intelligence, we ask citizens to provide us something more, such as classifying images, helping us think for us. And then on the third and fourth levels, we are asking for something more sophisticated. We are involving citizens as a full scientist into the proposal. So they are involved into the problem definition, what are the scientific research questions which are handled, and the data collection, the analysis. So it's a complete incorporation of the citizen into the scientific process, not just using the citizens, but also helping the citizens to do science. In order to reach this upper level of citizen science, what is required is its self-organization. And self-organization can be provided in the form of accepting proposals from the citizen, letting the citizen debate, voting, receiving comments, notification, and so on and so forth. For those of you who know Decidim, these are exactly what the Decidim platform offers. So it was quite a straight away to put these two things together. And we did this, and we created this platform, which we have called Decidim for CS, and it's available on Decidim for CS.nl. And basically what we have there is a Decidim instance with the wording changed and some functionalities changed to adapt to citizen science. And with this, I'm going to hand over to Maite. Oh, yeah, there are some example projects for Decidim for CS. We have worked on identifying evidences in the literature about children and COVID vaccination, and this has been done in the mark of the Geneva Tsinghua Initiative with the University of Geneva and the University of Tsinghua in China. There is also the Genigma project, which basically what we ask there is citizens to collaborate in building the reference genome, and this is basically was a collaboration which took place in the mark of the Barcelona International Genome Science Challenge. And there, infrastructure disability, where we work towards a more inclusive educational infrastructure, also with students from the University of Geneva. And now, I really hand over to
you. Okay. So, our team comes from the Artificial Intelligence Research Institute, just as Pablo and Jesús said, and also from the University of Barcelona. And we work on artificial intelligence, and in fact, these days, we are holding the Catalan Conference on Artificial Intelligence. And yesterday, we presented the work that we have been doing on artificial intelligence for the scheme. So I wanted to give you a brief details about what we have been doing and presenting just yesterday. So you might have in mind what a proposal in the CDM looks like. We have a proposal, and we characterize it symbolically. And for this proposal, people provide different comments, which we call arguments. So we might have arguments in favor and arguments against this proposal, but it is also the case that people provide their opinions about these arguments. So we can consider those arguments associated to opinions, and then our work has been to put together all this information and to aggregate automatically what will be the outcome of this debate. So we can automatically compute if this proposal should be accepted or rejected. Moreover, we have been working on defining resilience as a measure of debate quality. So we think of resilience as a robustness measure for decision upon the proposal to see how changes affect the decision. So for example, we might have a look at how can we add different counter arguments until the outcome of the debate, the decision upon the proposal, can be changed into a rejection, for example, if it was previously accepted. Moreover, we can also have a look at addition of opposed opinions. So again, the same, we can see how many synthetic or new opinions should we add until this proposal should be rejected. So the idea of resilience is that the more changes needed, the more resilient the outcome of the debate. So overall, we provide this information in a graphical way using rather diagrams. And of course, this is the example for the resilience, for the example I used. But there are also other resiliences for different proposals. That's all. Thank you very much for your attention. You can find the CDM for CS here, as Jesús said. Thank you.
Y ya por último pasaremos a la presentación que nos va a hacer Olivier Schulbaum de la Fundación Catalan, creo que nos lo he dicho bien.
Sí. No te he oído, Pablo, no lo sé. Hablaré en inglés para nuestros amigos de Suiza, creo que no, Suiza, Finlandia, Francia, pero creo que se han quedado en la fiesta, o sea que. Anyway, I speak English because that's the word. Bueno, no me veo
también. So, yo junto a Olivier también tenemos a Tayrine Dias de la Fundación Catalan.
Yes.
La Universidad Oberta de Cataluña y también.
And Tayrine will kick me in my leg before minutes exactly. So, we talk about the Catalan's proposal. So what is it? So, let me try. So, the idea around the Indices project is basically how can we democratize research. So, we've seen a couple of examples there. By basically promoting a space to create what we call hypotheses of research with visual data and accessible narrative data. So that's basically our session here. That's going on for a minute. Thank you very much. I'd like to go back. Basically, how can we open the doors to a wider participatory research? We know, since this project is about cultural heritage and measuring the impact, social impact of culture, usually see different things in observatories about observing the natural phenomena, like birds or like astronomy would be an example. Well, astronomy is one of the most exclusive, non-exclusive science actually. So that's basically why you also look at historical example, like this case of Wang Zhengzi, who was a famous change maker, famous scientist, and she was able to explain this, prove how equinoxes move. So it's an example. So basically what we do as part of Indices, sorry for that. It's basically we're building a collaborative online environment, just as the one we just seen, for deliberation, co-creation, and transparent dialogue between actors who usually don't dialogue with participatory tools, basically cultural heritage professionals, policymakers, researchers, and purely citizen and makers. So basically our session is to create a space for better understanding of the social and economic impact of digitization of culture. So we basically started with the classic Decidim, we all know about it. Actually, the co-creation of the observatory itself is an internal process that they're inspired by the Decidim, but that was not it, all right? So basically, we realized in various projects, both charge and academics freak out with the operational design behind Decidim, right? So both of them think, fuck out, it's too complicated, we know about that. So we really need to work about it, but it reminds me, the architecture behind Decidim reminds me of what's the backbone on the backstage of what a beautiful museum. So look at all these treasures, these beautiful birds, you will never see them. Think about all these beautiful participatory processes in this ambassador, you will never see them. Because basically there's no dialogue possible, right? So that's basically our own challenge. So we need some new ingredients, and we have developing new ingredients, and I'll tell a bit about some of them, but very quickly because we don't have time. Custom fields for proposals. So don't give a white paper to a tribe or to an academic, they think the same. So I need to have a structure to think. Okay, so here's the structure. So we do develop the custom field proposal, and we have a demonstration this afternoon with the Make This Seem Marvelous again. We also need conversations, bring back conversations. So we basically bring that module, notify And it's basically about taking notes of an assembly or whatever collective thinking we're having, and it's, you know, with the threads, interesting enough, we're tracking who has said what. That's very important when we talk about citizen assemblies, for example. That's so important to recognize the authorships of who has said what in the debates, and it's important that the author is able to come back and edit its own comments, right? Even if I think so, not to depend on non-neutrality of note takers. We need visual deliberation, charts, and academics need that. So we took it out of Decidim because we can't do that right now on Decidim. But an example of how we decided on what are our ethical pillars of a project. So this golden pinch gets back to Decidim, and we use the accountability module to basically take some examples. So we have a principle called accessibility diversity, where we find actions and indicators, and we measure that, and it's transparent, so everybody can know citizen science and European funding goes the way it should go. Basically, and that's almost there in sign, the novelty of the project is that visual data and data analytics is in a standard of deliberation. So, not as, you know, fireworks that nobody understands and only experts can understand and express as a hypothesis for society. Here we try to integrate this in and visual analytics, and that's the last year. You want me to? Okay, we need some data literacy, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. So we need some data literacy before jumping into the visual data analytics.
Basically, what we're trying to do here, whether by science, is to democratize a bit the access to research and the intersection with culture, is exactly to try to understand trends and signals from noise. So, to do that, we are trying to integrate two technologies here, Decidim and this dashboard that basically offers visualization over a bunch of sources, so either from the lab, from end user outlets, or from social media, etc. So here is what we can exactly see as a hypothesis author view. So using the custom fields for actually creating a hypothesis, and the first hypothesis that we wanted to explore was exactly gender inequality in cultural heritage institutions. So here, one of the possible views of visualizations is exactly a tech cloud, so we can see a bit the sentiment analysis, what that's going to look like. And another possible visualization as well is with the graph of keywords. So that allows us to understand a bit better what's going on when it comes to gender inequalities in cultural heritage institutions. And from that,
just saying that's happening while you write your proposal.
That's the hypothesis also in the public. And from that, what we did was take the information that we found from the dashboard from the integration of the two technologies and go back to five treasures. So that definitely feed on the loop to look for more information, and those were part of the treasures that we found information from the keywords that we had in the visualizations in the platform. So our effort here basically is to try to chip away, as we're seeing here in the slide, between the big institutional reports, basically information that's very privileged just in big institutional services on ASCO, and try to develop spaces for different skills of reporting, data gathering, action, and interaction. So to keep on doing that, a little bit of an announcement advertising here on the 23rd and the 24th, we're holding a bootcamp, and that's basically on reimagining data as code for assets. So I re-invite you, as platonic, all of you, if you are interested in learning more and seeing more of what's happening. You know, this is Open Observatory. We're going to be holding that event those 3 days. It's going to be awesome with four test courses. We're going to be working on data proposals, also on gender inequality in CHIs, and many more. So thank you very much, and I hope to see you in the event.
Tenemos tiempo para una pregunta, no para un comentario o una opinión, para una pregunta. ¿Del público?
Sí, una pregunta, pero Oliver, muy gracias. I was asking, I was wondering if the visualization and the data dashboard is part of the participatory process, or is something that happens behind the doors, with your background, while the discussion and the project is made. Thank you.
It's most definitely part of the participatory process. So our intention is exactly like from the beginning in establishing hypotheses of what might be going on, what are the trends or issues or signals that practitioners, citizens, whomever might be interested when it comes to culture, when they identify any of that, they propose, they can create a hypothesis on the platform, and from that directly already see the visualization, and from that you can have a feedback loop, be able to go back to find more charges from the information that they found from the visualization by writing the hypothesis, and from that you have the space for conversations. You can have most definitely deliberation from the visualization that is being generated on the platform.
Just to add, the dashboard in itself is not part of the scene, but you can just like also do the other way around. Just navigate the dashboard and just fix the moment of your navigation and say, I have a new hypothesis about the data, and just like, you know, focusing on right now, and then press the button and publish the hypothesis or the date, and then you jump into the decision.
Yeah,